Can you tell me which one the large red snapper is? Which fish? Because I have no clue.
Here at FDA, we receive many questions regarding proper seafood labeling.
So this is the large red.
In this video, we'll talk about seafood labeling, and after each segment, there will be a few questions to review the material and help reinforce key points. Segment 1 describes the purpose of labeling, the role and authority of the FDA, and some possible reasons why seafood may be mislabeled. Segment 2 provides FDA's specific laws, regulations, and guidance documents relevant to seafood labeling. Segment 3 illustrates FDA's current work to discourage the mislabeling of seafood and offers specific tips for regulators, retailers, and consumers in a combined effort to ensure proper seafood labeling. The purpose of labeling is to inform the consumer regarding the contents of the product. This information helps protect both consumers and manufacturers and prevents fraud, misrepresentation, and unfair competition. When all producers follow the same labeling rules, it creates an even playing field that prevents unscrupulous persons from misrepresenting their product to deceive consumers and to create an unfair advantage for themselves. The Food and Drug Administration develops laws to define proper labeling, provides guidance to industry and advice to consumers, and oversees the labeling of products as part of their inspection activities. The FDA administers and enforces those labeling requirements for nearly all foods. A notable exception would be for meat and poultry, which falls under the jurisdiction of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. It's FDA's responsibility to ensure that the seafood industry processes and distributes seafood that is wholesome and properly labeled. FDA's regulatory authority for food labeling is found in the Federal Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act, the Fair Packaging and Labeling Act, the Public Health Service Act, and the Food Allergen Labeling and Consumer Protection Act. When seafood is incorrectly labeled, the regulatory action taken regarding the identity of a product usually falls under the misbranding provision of the Act. The provision states that a food shall be deemed misbranded if the labeling is false or misleading, offered for sale under another name, or as an imitation of another food but doesn't contain the word imitation on the label. Some examples of seafood mislabeling include inaccurate food weight declarations, such as low net or drained weights, or including water glaze as part of net weight, not declaring the use of preservatives or color treatments, not declaring added water, species substitution, and labeling salad containing surimi as crab salad. When purchasing products, consumers rely on labels to clearly and accurately describe what's being offered for sale. Consumers rely on product labeling to provide vital information that may affect their health, such as a possible allergic reaction or specific nutritional needs. Consumers use this information to make informed decisions regarding their dietary needs and possible health precautions. Today's consumers are better informed about environmental contaminants or general food health concerns surrounding allergens, salt content, or other nutritional needs. FDA conducts label reviews during regular food safety inspections and when evaluating imported seafood. FDA also investigates consumer complaints presented to the agency. These reviews are to ensure that the labels are truthful and not misleading. The agency follows a regulatory evaluation process to determine the compliance of the label. When FDA determines a product is not labeled as required by law, the agency may take any and all appropriate actions. Actions may include detaining and refusing imported seafood, issuing warning letters, or seizing the products, depending on individual circumstances. Let's look at some reasons for mislabeling seafood. Economic fraud occurs when a product is mislabeled, when damage is concealed, or when a product is made to appear better than it is. These practices can deceive the consumer. There are laws that set forth standards of identity. One of these standards is for raw breaded shrimp and defines the flesh to breading ratio. Overbreading occurs when excessive breading is added to increase the weight of the product. Because the regulation requires at least 50% flesh content to breading, an example of economic fraud is if raw breaded shrimp contains 60% breading content, which means the consumer is paying shrimp prices for bread. Short weighting occurs when the weight stated on the packaging is not the actual weight of the product. Sometimes the weight of the water or ice with the product is included as part of the declared weight. So basically, you're paying seafood prices for water. And sometimes net package content weights have not been adjusted from gross package weights, which include product packaging. Additives are sometimes used to make products appear better than they are or to mask signs of decomposition. For example, the use of carbon monoxide to make flesh retain its red color for an extended period of time. And sometimes a less expensive fish species is substituted for a more expensive species. An example would be when another snapper species is substituted for red snapper, or when parrotfish is substituted for grouper. Another reason for mislabeling seafood is to avoid regulatory requirements. Some reasons may include the avoidance of tariffs and other taxes, the offering of restricted or endangered species into commerce, or an attempt to circumvent FDA import alerts. Here we see several examples of known species substitution. Column A contains examples of lesser-priced seafood that have been substituted for the more expensive seafood contained in column B. Common examples of species substitution shown here include rockfish being represented as red snapper, mako shark being incorrectly identified as swordfish, and steelhead trout falsely labeled or identified as salmon. Processed seafood products can also be mislabeled. Use of the term caviar, unqualified without a fish species name on the label, can only be used to represent fish eggs from the sturgeon species. All other species of roe, processed into caviar, should be labeled with the type of fish the eggs come from, such as salmon caviar or paddlefish caviar. The FDA has a compliance policy guide which describes the proper labeling of caviar, which will be noted in segment 2. Species substitution is not only an economic concern, it can also be a food safety concern by causing potential food safety hazards to be misidentified or overlooked. If we look at the actual species of Escalar, we note the potential species-related hazards of gempilotoxin and histamine. If the seafood product is inappropriately identified as grouper or sea bass, then the wrong potential hazards, parasites and ciguatera fish poisoning are being controlled, leaving the consumer at risk of illness from gempilotoxin and or histamine. Now, look at Spanish mackerel. Spanish mackerel has the potential species-related hazards of histamine and ciguatera fish poisoning. If this fish is incorrectly identified as kingfish, which has no identified potential hazards, then once again consumers are at risk of illness because the true hazards will not have been controlled. Another hazard to consider with fishery products is allergens. Consumers may be allergic to a specific species of fish and rely heavily on truthful labeling to avoid what could be a severe allergic reaction. Escalar has been known to be substituted for such fish species as grouper and sole. The most common mislabeling we see for Escalar is white tuna, which has been noted at some retail outlets and sushi restaurants. Escalar and its closely related cousin, the oilfish, have been associated with illness caused by gempilotoxin. Gempilotoxin has been known to cause a purgative or laxative-like action when consumed, and FDA recommends that these fish not be marketed. Check our website for additional information about these fish. Now, a short review quiz.